The divine consciousness is plenary consciousness, full consciousness, as if thousands of lights of suns are collected together in that sun of the divine. And inconscience is exactly the opposite of it. Now, the divine has many possibilities. He is omnipotent. He can have many kinds of objects. All possible objects are possible for the divine. In a childish way, we may say that he can play many kinds of games. All possible games are possible for the divine. And this time in which we are living, the divine has chosen to play this game. First, to conceal his consciousness so completely as to become inconscient. There is a production of inconscience, and then to play the game of unveiling it. But in the process of unveiling, since it's a game, there is a rule. Like in cricket you have rules, in chess you have rules, in football you have rules of game. Here also a rule is made. The rule of the game is that this inconscience has to be developed gradually, not at once. Divine can immediately, by one stroke of ray of light, inconscience can become conscious. That is possible. It's such a super conscious that inconscience, it just sends one ray of light and it becomes conscious. It is possible. But the rule of the game is that it allows inconscience to develop gradually. You might almost say leisurely. There is no hurry in this process. Second rule of the game is that this inconscience becomes gradually conscious by a double process. There is first an invitation sent by consciousness asking the inconscience, "May I come? May I throw myself on you? Can I awake you?" It does not impose itself. It says, "I want to come here, but I don't want to impose myself on you." It's like a good teacher. A good teacher sends out an invitation. "Would you like to study?" No imposing on you. "If you want to study, I am here with you. But you have to decide whether you want to study or not." The inconscience is given a choice to say yes or no. Usually inconscience does not want to respond to this invitation because it is unconscious. It is in sleep, and as you know, in sleep one does not like to be awakened. One likes to continue to sleep. We have all our experience. When you are sleeping and somebody says, "Now wake up," we want to avoid getting up as much as possible. 5 minutes more, 5 minutes more, we say. So similarly, inconscience has normally this response. The divine consciousness is very careful not to impose itself, so waits until the inconscience comes to a point where it says, "All right, I will receive a little," consents to it. It happens to consent at one time. Why? Because it's free to say yes or no, and it is quite possible for you to say yes also one time. the moment it says yes, the divine knows how much dose to give. Not to give too much because it will become shaken, and divine doesn't want to shake up. It gives exact dosage of consciousness so as to be able to receive well. Now the divine gives this kind of invitation through many intermediaries, directly and also through many intermediaries. All the instruments of the divine, which are conscious in one way or the other, they can all collaborate. Principally there are two intermediaries. One is God's and second is our souls. We are the two intermediaries, God's and our souls. Gods also invite. There are many gods. Gods are nothing but children of the divine, but conscious children of the divine. They have not fallen into sleep. As far as we are concerned, we have fallen into sleep, but not totally. There is something in us which is still awake, but it is very deep. On the surface as we are living, we hardly are aware of that which we are truly, which is awake. So our message also reaches this outer being very slowly. Whatever is in unconscious hardly receives any message from our deep soul because the distance is very great. You know, we know in astronomy the distances between stars, as we now know, are so great that for one ray of light to come from one star to the other sometimes takes millions and millions of light years, not only years, but light years. Such are the distances in the world. So if that is the case, then the distance between the divine consciousness and the inconscience, the distance is very, very great. Similarly, the distance between our real soul, which is awake, and our outer self, which we are, is also very great. That is why there is a lot of time required for us to communicate the will of the divine to the inconscience. But this is the real game. The inconscience has to agree, first of all, to receive the light. On the other side, there's a constant invitation coming from above, may I come, may I come, I want to come, I would like to come, I want to awaken you. All the time it is coming. As a result, there is a constant dialogue, as it were. Our life is nothing but a dialogue, constant dialogue. And the main refrain of dialogue is only this, may I come? And the answer is sometimes no, sometimes all right, sometimes yes, yes. This is all the dialogue, this is the main refrain of the dialogue, constantly. Our entire life can be summarized only in these three words. May I come? And answer no, maybe, all right, yes, yes. Our whole life can be summarized in this. There is nothing more than that in life. But because of this process and because of this rule of the game, it can take a long time. Neither inconscience is worried about the time, nor the divine is worried about the time. They all have all the time, as it were, leisure, because it is a big game going on. Only we human beings are in a hurry, because sometimes when our consciousness becomes partially conscious and partially sleeping, then the sense of hurry, the sense of speed and all that arises. Now in this process it has taken billions of years you might say, for the whole game to come to the point where we are now. So let us come to where we are. Billions of years have already passed. Now we are where we are. And the same dialogue continues. Only the point is that we are partially conscious. Now this partial consciousness is called in technical language ignorance. So there is a distinction which is made between inconscience and ignorance. Inconscience is complete negation of consciousness. There is complete darkness. And ignorance is like the night. The night is also dark. But in night there are stars, isn't it? So there are twinkling lights all the time. So our consciousness is like the dark night, having some twinkling going on. So our consciousness is not totally dark. We are called ignorant, not inconscient, but we are ignorant. So there is some development has taken place. From complete inconscience, we have reached the point of some consciousness, but partial consciousness. Now this law of ignorance, the game at the level of ignorance, becomes very, very interesting. When we are ignorant, partially conscious and partially unconscious, that is why the whole human life is a very interesting drama. That is why dramatists, when they write drama, they become extremely like themselves, like gods. It is said that an author, a dramatist particularly, enjoys the company of God. When you begin to write a drama, you will see, if you begin to write a drama, or write a story even, a novel or fiction or short story, you almost become like God. Because you create characters, then you imagine that some plot must be there, you invent that some people will meet, there will be some friction, some friendship, some quarrel, some misunderstanding, and then overcoming of difficulties, some kind of a drama will take place. At a certain point of this drama, our consciousness becomes so desperate. We become so full of the need to receive the light that we say, light, 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 come, I want light. And then you will see the light comes very rapidly. Now when the light comes, what happens? You begin to remember your contract.